Hello and welcome to Sinfini TV. I'm Cyrus Mehomji, and on today's program, crystalline fingerwork informs Chinese pianist Yuja Wang's new recordings of the Ravel Concertos. Riccardo Chailly brings zest, exhilaration, and breathes new life into the orchestral music of Brahms. And Peter and the Wolf moves from Russia to Hollywood, with the role of Peter's grandfather played by a hippie surfer. Sergei Prokofiev was a genius. Fancy coming up with animals to introduce kids to the instruments of the orchestra. Peter and the Wolf is scored for narrator and orchestra, and there's been every manner of narrator for performances and recordings of these, including such celebrities as David Bowie, Sting, Paul Hogan, Dame Edna Everage, and even Eleanor Roosevelt.
The wolf hunt continues. Police helicopters are searching downtown while ground forces continue.
Peter and the Wolf in Hollywood is a brand new take on Prokofiev's children's classic. We've taken the original tale, which takes place in old-time Russia, and we've transposed it into modern times Hollywood.
We have created a whole new story which precedes the Prokofiev story of Peter and the Wolf. The idea behind this is to create a sense for where all these characters actually came from and how they got to know each other.
And I get to do all the characters.
She was wearing designer sunglasses and a pearl collar, sipping a fruity drink with a little paper umbrella in it.
It was sort of like going back to being 5, 6, 7 years old.
This young kid who just arrived from Russia after he lost his parents.
Living with his grandfather, an aging hippie surfer, working as a gardener on the grand estate of a movie star.
He wasn't expecting his grandfather at all to be an old hippie. And that kind of gives it a nice dynamic. We had to come up with a bird voice that was going to be this sort of little British bird voice. The wolf. I always kind of fantasize that there's wolves up there in Hollywood Hills.
The kid is not just watching the story like he would watch a film. He's really called to action.
The story recounts the adventure of a boy who unintentionally becomes a Hollywood celebrity by catching a wolf that has escaped from the zoo.
He is absolutely determined. When it comes to wolves, he knows his business.
And before grandfather could stop him, Peter jumped on his bike and took off after the wolf.
All the little worlds that we're creating for Peter and the Wolf in Hollywood are first conceived as drawings. Those drawings are built in three dimensions with cardboard and plaster of Paris and anything that we have on hand. The world that we bring to life is something in between sculpture, painting, drawing, photography, video, and this mashup, this sort of amalgamation of mediums, has a very peculiar and wonderful quality of its very own.
What's unique about this app is the fact that every piece was recorded with a live orchestra. We have this musical soundtrack created by one of the most wonderful youth orchestras in the world. In the prequel, we use Mahler, Wagner, Smetana, Grieg, Elgar, Schumann.
It's not only an app, it's a CD, it's a digital album. This is going to be a very exciting piece of entertainment.
The Chinese pianist Yuja Wang has become quite a sensation, in demand as a concerto soloist and recitalist around the world. Her most recent recording is that of the two Ravel concertos and the Fauré ballade for solo piano. And it all begins with a whip crack.
Recording the complete cycle of the orchestral works, and Yuja is our artist in residence. We just had a really great tournée in Europe. The orchestra really welcomed her. She's really part of the orchestra. She's part of our family, of the Tonhalle Orchestra.
Mm-hmm.
Like he said, it's like a family. You know, it's the first orchestra I played with when I was 15 in Europe, so it has certain very close feeling about it. Close enough for me to actually take this adventure to record Ravel.
Orchestra is really amazing at finding all the different range of dynamics. The most important thing is that I realize this orchestra is very good at playing like chamber music, which is always my goal. It's extremely important that musicians listen to each other.
I realize how marvelous or exquisite Ravel's orchestration is.
Written both concerti in the same time, but Ravel said clearly the G major was inspired from Mozart and Saint-Saëns and has a much lighter atmosphere and was supposed to be called Rhapsody Basque. So we can feel this clearly in the joyful finale.
Eagle-eyed among you might have noticed that the score that the pianist uses is on an iPad, which saves turning lots of pages, given the plethora of notes to be tackled in the G major concerto.
It's really one of my favorite pieces. It just has something much more dark, probably because it was written from the war, and very primal. And it's very improvisatory, but in a way leads to kind of something inevitable and almost like fate. Every harmony is like just so magically aligned. It's just a magical piece.
Ravel's later D major concerto was written for the left hand only and was commissioned by the Austrian pianist Paul Wittgenstein, who lost his right arm during the First World War. There are many competitive recordings here. I don't think this brooding piece is as well suited to Yuja Wang's temperament as the scintillating G major. The darker undercurrents have best been explored by Alethea de la Rocha on her Decca recording. Leonard Bernstein makes a very colorful splash in his recording of the G major concerto, in which he takes the very brave step of directing the New York Philharmonic from the keyboard. Speaking of left hands, the pianist Valentina Lisitsa has been busy recording rarities and surprises by Scriabin, the Russian composer who died 100 years ago. Scriabin was very influenced by synesthesia, associating colors with music, and also very influenced by the music of Frédéric Chopin, as demonstrated in the beautiful prelude for Left Hand Alone he wrote early in his career. Lisitsa recorded it for her much-followed YouTube channel, and a fan commented, "Valentina, you are a goddess as a pianist. I often describe your playing as akin to perfectly massaging a lion into submission and hypnosis." Several countries have their light operas, the British their Gilbert and Sullivan, the Spanish their zarzuelas. For Austria, and specifically Vienna, it's operetta, a never-never land of handsome hussar officers, princes and princesses, counts and countesses, and romantic gypsies beloved of the bourgeois Viennese, who probably would hate to meet a real gypsy. Into this world entered Franz Lehár, and the latest recording of his popular operetta, The Merry Widow, stars soprano diva Renee Fleming, the Broadway legend Kelly O'Hara, and veteran baritone Sir Thomas Allen.
We hear the music play. I feel your body sway. Your heart is beating fast. If only love could speak at last. But since nothing can be done, if only we could dance instead, you know that it is true.
The Italian conductor Riccardo Chailly has had a long history of recording with Decca. His is an especially keen ear for both musical nuance and attention to detail. Between 2006 and 2014, he was busy with Brahms, a composer whose concertos and symphonies he's performed and recorded to tremendous acclaim. The symphonies were declared Gramophone's Record of the Year in 2014.
Now I understand why I'm more confident with Brahms than Beethoven. Very simple, I rationally never thought of it, but it's clear because when I was still a student at Milan Conservatory of Music, in 1972, Claudio Abbado asked me to be his assistant in La Scala. And at the time I was 19 years old. And the first thing, very easy thing he asked me, you have to prepare me reading the symphonies of Brahms, the whole four, which I do in one season, I do the complete cycle. Before I arrived, the orchestra should have made the reading rehearsal with you. I said, oh, Jesus, and now what am I going to do with that? And Claudio was very kind, because I was so bloody young at the time, that we sat hours together with the score of each symphony. He gave me all kind of indications. This experience gave me the courage to make my debut with La Scala Orchestra at the age of 19, I will never forget, Fourth Symphony of Brahms in an orchestra pit. And in the darkness of La Scala, I had to give this upbeat C, so, to the, out of nothing, from an orchestra pit. It was very surrealist, the situation. And that gave me the stomach energy to fight through also the difficulty to meet an orchestra like that, and the shyness being so young to rehearse a Brahms symphony. And that went on with the other symphonies, and that gave me then confidence enough to start performing Brahms, and I could learn from that.
We'll be right back. We also get the serenades, the two piano concertos with Nelson Freire, the double concerto with Vadim Repin and Truls Merk, and the violin concerto with the Greek violinist Leonidas Kavakos.
The whole writing is very pianistic. I cannot imagine what it must have been before Joachim interfered, because already the way it is, the double stops, the way they're written, are really not comfortable. There is no comfortable moment. Maybe the most comfortable part of the piece is the second movement in terms of playing. But there you have this incredible challenge. The theme starts being fragmented.
Yes,
fragmented. But then you have this incredible dialogue with the orchestra. That you have to really integrate. And we said that we have to really achieve that we continue.
Yeah.
That the one gives to the other the music.
It should be really a dialogue, not just an accompaniment, you know, from the orchestra point of view. It is an interference of a dialogue, one to each other.
So again, in this way, it's not, for instance, what one would expect from a violin concerto, where violin is a melodic mm-hmm. instrument and should just kind of sing. But here we have this incredible
integration and interaction
between orchestra and violin. And this has to be so homogeneous.
There have been dozens of Brahms orchestral cycles and many virtuous ones. With the very same orchestra, Kurt Masur recorded a cycle of symphonies and concertos too, and it's probably my favorite. Traditional performances, but astonishingly lyrical, and probably the most breathtaking opening to the fourth I've heard. There are virtues in Karajan's several cycles with the Berlin Philharmonic. Sir Adrian Bolt made a stunning but little-known recording too, reissued a couple of years ago by Warner. Claudio Bado made at least two complete cycles, the first with four different orchestras for the four symphonies, and one which contains the most fiery version of the second I know. These recordings by Riccardo Chailly deliver lean, muscular performances of Brahms. But with Italy's melodic tradition coursing through his veins, they are also lyrical and passionate. A remarkable cycle for our century, and whether or not you agree with everything Chailly does, it's truly gripping.
It's the only, or one of the very few concertos where we actually have a cadenza not from the composer himself, but actually from the violinist that he worked with so closely. And his link to the piece is stronger than anybody
exactly.
will ever have.
I agree.
And that's also the reason that I insist and choose to play this cadenza. One of my colleagues in the orchestra, just before the first rehearsal, he actually came and gave me as a present this two photos of Joachim and Brahms and the photocopy of the program. When this was first performed, you know, saying concert, you know, conducted, it's actually manuscript, new manuscript conducted by composer Johannes Brahms. I said, thank you very much. That makes me feel very comfortable now. The more you look at it, the more you realize how small we all are in front of these manuscripts. And that is actually very scary. Here you have a score that will never change. And yet, every time you look at it, you think, oh, why did I not see this last time? The music does not change, the score does not change. It's the same, even we use the same score because we mark things and so on. But yet, this thing projects more and more information, and that is my guide not only for Brahms but for any music that I might play, that you know, we are always smaller than the scores.